Hey there, is today your first time here? Or maybe your first time in a while? If so, maybe you're wondering exactly who we are and what this church is all about. Well, we'd like you to know that we're a group of ordinary people who are on an amazing journey together, following Christ. Our guide is the Bible because it's the divinely inspired word of God and it will never take us in the wrong direction. Along the way, we hope you'll see that we are welcoming and spiritually passionate and that getting to know you is a big deal to us. We know that the road is rough sometimes, but we'll work really hard to bring you practical and relevant messages to equip and encourage you through life's ups and downs. We want you to know that we care about this community, and we believe that it's our job to make it a better place. So, no matter who you are or where you've been, we're glad you're here with us today. And we hope that you'll join us on our journey, following Christ and living out His plan for us. So, welcome to church.
Thank you. Good morning, Somerville Family Worship Center. Y'all glad to be here? Y'all stand with us if you will. God is good. He is here in this place. I feel him already. I'm so thankful, so grateful. I've been waiting all week for a Sunday morning. I could use a Sunday morning. How about y'all? Psalm 23. Might sound a little familiar to y'all, but listen to it. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. Another translation says, the Lord is my shepherd. I have all I need. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside the still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Even when I'm walking through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod, your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup is running over this morning. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. How many of y'all claim that promise this morning? Is it okay? Do I have y'all's permission to do a little southern twangy song? Can we start with that? Is that okay? Is that all right? If it comes out of this mouth, it's going to be twangy. Well, I saw the light. I saw the light. No more darkness. No more night. Now I'm so happy. No sorrow. Stranger in the night. Praise the Lord, I saw the light. I saw the light. I saw the light. No more darkness, no more night. Now I'm so happy, no sorrow inside. Praise the Lord, I saw the light. Just like a blind man, I wonder. Take a moment. If you see somebody in here, you haven't got to shake their hand yet, just take a moment. Go say hey real quick while we do this next one. When the shadows of this life is gone, I'll fly away like a bird from prison bars and thrown. I'm gonna fly away. I'll fly away. Praise the Lord. Did that get you? What did it say? If that don't light your fire, there you go. Y'all can have a seat for a moment. I'm going to ask Brother Harry Weaver. Y'all may recognize him from his Oscar-winning Christmas play performances.
Good morning. Good morning. Wow, like Eddie said, my blood's pumping. I'm ready. Those of you who don't know me, I'm Harry Weaver, leader of the men's ministry, along with Brother Justin and Doug and Jeff. We're coming together with Brother Eddie. We're promoting a new ministry we're trying to start. It's called Trail Life.
I am so excited.
Right. That's awesome. So this is a boys and men's group. It's kind of like scouting, only it's Christian-oriented. I'm just going to read their statement off their website here. It says, Trail Life USA is a church-based, Christ-centered, boy-focused mentoring and discipleship journey that speaks to the heart of a boy, established on timeless values derived from the Bible and set in the context of outdoor adventure. Boys from kindergarten through 12th grade are engaged in a troop setting by male mentors where they are challenged to grow in character, understand their purpose, serve their community, and develop practical leadership skills to carry out the mission for which they were created. So what we're going to do is this Saturday evening in the zone, about 6 o'clock, we're going to have a fellowship, kind of an introductory meeting. Now this is open to men that want to mentor boys. Maybe your son's grown and living their life, but you can still give back. That's a good thing to do. Any boys that their fathers are not around, you still come. You know, there'll be men that'll take care of you. And then, of course, fathers and sons. And we encourage you to come and check it out. We're going to have a good time Saturday night. We'll have a little cornhole set up, a little bit of sloppy joes and drinks and chips and that kind of thing. So we look forward to seeing you there. And also, I've been tasked to boost offering this week, which, since it's third Sunday, is about the land and the grounds. So think about that when you're giving. Alongside with your tithe that you owe God. So, with that, we'll go ahead and pray. Father God, thank you for this Sunday. Thank you for the opportunity to meet in your house. We thank you for this country where we can still worship freely, Lord. And we're just thankful, Lord, for all that you gave, especially through your son, Jesus, to save us. Father, we ask your blessing over this offering, Father. And we just thank you, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Stand back with us, continue in worship.
In the presence of my enemy. crucified for me. Oh, I'm gonna see in the middle of the storm.
For a moment and just give him praise, give him glory and honor for his faithfulness, for his goodness, for his mercy, for his gentleness. We praise you this morning, Lord. We worship you, Father. You are so good to us. Praise your name, God. Praise your holy name, Lord. In the middle of the storm. In the middle of the storm. You know, I thought about, you know, we have limited opportunities. We're going to get to heaven one day, and we're going to sing. It's going to be like the biggest Gaither homecoming slash Toby Mac slash whatever concert. It's going to keep going on and on and on. And it's going to be amazing. It's going to be amazing. And that's going to be something we get to do for eternity. But the chances that we have to sing in the middle of a storm are limited. The angels don't even get to do that, y'all. That's something that we're privileged to do, to stand in the middle of something and choose to praise God and choose to trust Him. So don't waste an opportunity. Don't waste those chances. I was, the women had their little tea party yesterday. Y'all had a lot of people at that thing. There was a bunch of people at that tea party. I don't think we're going to wear hats or anything Saturday over here. We won't do that. But Kaylee woke up extra early Saturday morning to make these brownies. And if I can share my trials with you for a moment. She woke up extra early to make these brownies. And she told me, don't let me oversleep. I got to make these brownies. So I woke her up. She got up, went in there, started making them. Well, the boys on the weekend, they do this thing where they camp out in the living room on the weekends. And so Jacob wakes up, smells these brownies. And unbeknownst to him, they weren't for us. So then Nate and Luke wake up, and Kaylee's in the shower, and I'm in the bedroom, half awake, half asleep, trying to figure out what day it is. And then Jacob comes in, and Kaylee says, "What are you eating? What are you eating?" He said, "You made us brownies for breakfast." So we walked in there, and Luke will scrape the top off of the brownies for whatever reason. So there's a section of that missing. Then Jacob had taken, he just made, it was a pan about that big, and he had put it into four squares. I don't know what he was doing, if that was going to be a sheet of brownie or what, but they had attacked that brownie tray. It was done. And Kaylee's like, she's on the verge of crying. I could see it. And then about 2 minutes later, we just start laughing about it. Just laughing hysterically about it. I said, you gotta tell people what happened. They'll understand. So we went to the pig and grabbed some not as good brownies, but some brownies. And it's just one of those moments where I felt, man, there's nowhere else I'd rather be. You could give me riches and, you know, a great career, and but there are blessings that the Lord has put in my life that money can't buy and that are priceless. And those moments happen every single day if we open our eyes and see them. And this song's called 10,000 Reasons. And I may not be able to list 10,000 reasons right now, but I bet every one of us could sit down and start writing the blessings of the Lord. Instead of writing down why we're stressed, instead of speaking those things like, well, I'm just stressed. I'm just blessed. How about that? Instead of we start speaking those things. So y'all help us sing this morning, because we are a blessed people. We are a loved people. We have at least 10,000 reasons in this building this morning. Bless the Lord, oh my soul. And oh my soul, worship His holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul. I worship Your holy name. The sun comes up, it's a new day dawn. It's time to sing Your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever
sing when the evening comes. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship His holy name.
You are good.
You're good, Lord. You're so good to us. You're never gonna let, never gonna let me down. You're never gonna let,
never gonna let me down.
He won't fail us.
You're never gonna let, you're never gonna let me down. You're never gonna let, you're never gonna let me down.
Let's do that again. Oh, you're never gonna let, you're never gonna let me down. You're never gonna let, you're never gonna let me down. You believe that this morning? You're never gonna let, you're never gonna let me down. Oh, you're never gonna let, you're never gonna let me down. You are good, you're good.
Stuff happening, a lot of stuff going on. The Lord is just doing amazing things, and He will never let us down. We may not understand it all. We may wonder what's going on, why things are happening, why Michael took a tumble on the motorcycle, was thrown airborne, landed in the grass. Could have landed in the road, but he landed in the grass, messing up some muscles in his back. Messing up some muscles in his back. It could have been a lot worse. Amen. Amen. God is good. Brother Andy Felker, a few weeks ago, coming to church, was rear-ended, totaled his truck. Said just a little stoved up. Could have been a lot worse. Amen. Amen. God is good to us. I want to continue to pray for Sister Helen. Lord will continue to minister to her. We went by to pray with her last Sunday. And for the first time, she told us this week, for the first time in the 6 months of her surgery, she was without pain. She felt good. And I thank God for that. Amen. 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 Unless you've ever been in pain, you don't know how appreciative it is to be without it. Some of us, unfortunately, know that pain is our constant friend and companion. And we choose to embrace some things to say, God, I want to thank you. It reminds me when I hurt so bad I can't hardly move. God, it could have been a lot worse. I can feel it. And I want to thank you for that, God. Because a lot of people just don't fare like that, folks. Amen. Amen. God's been so good to us today. I want to continue to pray for Sister Leela, Bill and Leela. Some of our newest attenders, newest members are going to be joining, officially joining soon. And just pray for her. The Lord will bless her. She's battling several things going on in her health. But I know our God is able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we ask or think. There's a power at work within us today called the Holy Spirit. And God wants to do great things for us, in us, through us, if we will allow Him. Father God, there are a lot of other needs, needs that have been mentioned, some unspoken requests that have been given. Just pray for my family, pray for this one, pray for that one. Lord, and You're mindful and you know exactly what's on each and everyone's heart today, on their mind, and in their thoughts today, God. You know exactly what's going on. By those who are watching by way of live stream today, You know their needs. I'm asking, God, You administer grace. I want to thank You for what You've already done. Thank You for what You're doing. Thank You for what You're going to do. By faith, according to Your word, we reach out now. The word tells us that You sent Your word to heal them. It wasn't just You sent the living word, but You've also given us the written word. We can speak Your word, God, hallelujah, which lets us know there's nothing too hard for You. Your word tells us all things are possible with You, God. Your word tells us You'll never leave us nor forsake us. Your word lets us know if we ask according to Your will in Your name, Lord, these things will be done. You are working all things together for our good. Thank You, Lord. That gives me hope that this one bad thing that's happening is not all there is to it. Hallelujah. This is just a part of a bigger picture that You're putting together, this puzzle that I call my life. You've seen it complete, and You know what it is. It will bring You glory. Let it bring You glory, God. Let it bring You honor today. Minister healing and strength in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Sing a little bit. When the night is holding on
to me,
weeping may endure for the night.
God is holding on.
But joy comes in the morning.
And when the night is holding on to me, my God is holding on. For You are good. You're good, oh, oh, You are good, You're good, oh, yes, You are good, You're good, oh, Lord, You are good, You're good, oh.
Hallelujah. Thank You, Lord. You're so good to us. Praise God. You may be seated. What a wonderful week the Lord has given us. And as we're thinking about how good God has been to us, the Lord blessed my wife and I to be able to fly up to see our Brittany and Luke and the kids and hang out there for a few days. It was nice to be able just to fly an hour and a half to hour and 10, 15 minutes or so, be there and, you know, just ride through the country about an hour and a half to get to where they are. No matter where we land, it's any airport we choose, it's an hour and a half to their house. So we just take, I'm sorry, an hour to their house with Luke driving. Hour and a half of Shirley driving. I'm just kidding. Lord, I'm thank God I'm alive. Hallelujah. Luke, if you watch this and see this, praise God. I know I have guardian angels watching over me, boy. He had us all praying two or three times, man. But it was so great. And just to be able to be there, the kids latching on to us. And if you're a grandparent, you know what that is. If you're a parent, you know what it is. When they hold on and just hang on and want to be everywhere you're at and play games and do stuff. And so we got to go to our first, I'm 63 years young and never had gone to a professional baseball game. To be honest, when I was younger, I thought it was boring. I didn't care nothing about baseball. Because, you know, they pitched a no-hitter. Well, what good is that? I want to see some action. Hit the ball. Do something, you know. But at my age now, it was relaxing. It was so nice to be. We were three tiers up right behind home plate, looking across the Ohio River. The paddle boats in the background on the... And then they go up the water. And it's just so cool to watch all that. And my wife, like a kid in a candy store, she was, this is great. I love it. And one of the highlights of that game was, of course, watching John get into the game. And of course, we had to wear Cincinnati red. We had to be a Cincinnati fan while we were there and holler for our team. And it was pretty cool. And of course, I remember going way back as a boy, some of the names and some of the Johnny Bench and different players. I remember some of the guys. But little Addie was sitting in my lap, and I had opened some stacks of potato chips and set them there. And she'd reach that little tiny hand down, and she could get it right in that sleeve easy. She'd get her a potato chip, and then she'd take a bite, and she'd look up at me. She'd get a potato chip and just do this. She didn't even have to look. I was trying to. And she just sat there the whole time. She'd get another one. She'd get one, just go. It was so great. We laughed so hard about that. It was great memories. And then being with them was wonderful. Then yesterday, we were able to be with Jessica and Stephen and the kids as well. So to be with all of our kids in 1 week, I thank God we can do that. Yeah. I thank God we live close enough to do that. We have the means of transportation to do that. And my wife did a wonderful, wonderful job yesterday and her team getting this together. Yeah. You'll see this. Yeah. Welcome, ladies, to the Somerville Family Worship Center ladies' tea. We're about 45 ladies there and kids, and they had a wonderful time. And so she wants to give thanks to all of you who participated, all of you who decorated, all of you who made food, brought food, served food, whatever you did, and the men's ministry team for being there. Deacon Mark Clyde, washing dishes. True heart of a servant, son. I love you. And all these sweet folks. I told my wife, I love this. It's like Nancy has an angel on her shoulder, and Harry's seeing who the guy is. Isn't that great? I told my wife, I said, did you know that's Harry? And that's Harry? She said, yeah, I know. I just threw it up there. So anyway, I thought it was just, we wanted to share that, just say thank you. Thank you. It was a wonderful time. We got to serve and be able to participate and eat some of the food, which was wonderful, and then fellowship. A few weeks ago, about a month ago, I started some series on messages I've been preaching on consecration, sanctification, dedication, and things. It's just, there's more to the story. And maybe it's just the stage in my life. Maybe it's just where I'm at. Maybe this is not even for you. Maybe this is just for me. But boy, the Lord has really just, in this time of quiet and rest and sitting there looking over a ball field, and the Lord, like Eddie said, and I loved, beautiful, beautiful. What great. I wouldn't rather be any place else than right there in that moment. I can picture that, because that's what I would have done. Now, she would have cried. I would have laughed. I'd have gotten there and ate the brownies with them and then laughed even harder. You know, you're a brave. Did he do it? Ah, see, you didn't tell that. But to just moments of memories. The older I get, the realize how fleeting life is and how precious those moments are. And I was asking the Lord, boy, I've tried to instill a lot in my kids and my grandkids. And again, the older I'm getting, maybe it's my mindset. I'm thinking, what could I really just leave them? What could I? And I was telling the men that here this morning, I want to be great at what I do. I want to aspire to greatness. Just wrote a book, and I want to be a great author. I want to be a great husband. I want to be a great parent. I want to be a great minister. I don't think it's wrong for us to think in that manner, because God has created us for greatness. I believe that. Is that not what he told Adam? You're going to have dominion over everything. I don't think that's wrong. But where we mess up is we forget it's his job to be great. It's our job to be consecrated to his greatness. And boy, that thing hit me. I began to weep before the Lord. I grabbed my guitar and began to sing before the Lord. I will do it. It's not because I didn't get to play this morning. I asked to take today off. I just wanted to relax and chill a little bit with my wife on the front pew. We don't get to do that much. But so in my devotion time, I sat down and I just began to seek the Lord. And this is how I, okay, this is just me. When I'm by myself, okay, this is me. Who are we that you would be mindful of us? What do you see that's worth looking our way? Lord, I'm free in ways that I never should be. Sweet release from the grip of these chains. Like hinges swinging from the way my heart no longer can keep from singing. All that is within me cries, for you alone be glorified, Emmanuel, God with us. Now my heart sings a brand new song. My debt is paid. Thank God my chains are gone. Emmanuel, God with us. So in my prayer time, I'm asking God, what can I do? To make a difference for you as your pastor, to make a difference for my children. And with that song was, I surrender all. I surrender all. After all, folks, if we haven't surrendered all, we haven't surrendered everything. If he's not Lord of all, he's not Lord of everything. So I don't know where you're at in your life, but that's just a little walk through where I'm feeling. And so I began to seek the Lord about today and was asking him, I want you to do mighty things, God. And my mind came to a book by Matt Batterson on, it's called All In. If you've never read it, you need to read it. It's a great book. And I think his one of his books, I know I have several. One is the about the circle. The circle maker, you draw the circle and you stand inside that circle and you pray until God moves. He uses the illustration about circling like they did Jericho, circling, circling, circling until God tells you it's time. Some of us get so impatient. We don't wait for God to do the great things. We want to try to make something happen. And God is saying, let me do my job. Let me do what I do best. And so with that, the thought hit me, the pattern has been set for amazing things. It's already been set. All we need to do is walk in that, yield to that, believe and trust him. Joshua 3 is a great example. In Joshua 3, directions are being given for crossing the River Jordan. Now, when I stand up here and preach to you on Sunday, I am giving you directions. I'm giving you instructions. Amen. The word of God is good. It's profitable for doctrine, for correction, for reproof, for discipline. It's good to be able to share instruction. Did you realize these things that have been written, these things that I'm sharing with you every Sunday, or we have on Wednesday nights for a Bible study or Thursday night, these things we are sharing, the Bible says they were written for our learning. They are an example for us. We need to learn something from them. Amen. Amen. And so in Joshua 3, directions were given for crossing. Joshua rose early in the morning, and they removed from Shittim and came to Jordan. He and all the children of Israel lodged there before they passed over. Came to pass after 3 days, the officers went through the host, and they commanded the people, saying, when you see the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord your God and the priests and the Levites bearing it, then you shall remove from your place and go after it. He goes through and he begins to give some instruction. We'll come back to it in a moment. But the key verse I want us to look at is that the Lord, he said, sanctify, verse 5, sanctify yourselves or consecrate yourselves, for tomorrow the Lord will do wonders or do amazing things among you. God's getting ready to show out and show off. A few weeks ago, if you were here, a message and interpretation was given, and the Holy Spirit said this to us, I am God. And he says, I am walking up and down the aisles of this church looking to show myself great. Do you remember that? I remember that. And I grabbed the word of God. The first thing that came to my mind was 2 Chronicles 20, where it talked about how that, 2 Chronicles 16 and 9, where it talked about for the eyes of the Lord or the Spirit of the Lord is roaming to and fro all over the earth seeking someone to show himself mighty on their behalf whose hearts are loyal to him. And I thought about that thing. God, you want to do amazing things in our lives. However, doing mighty things is God's job. Consecration is ours. This is where ministry gets in trouble. This is where churches get in trouble. When you think it's all about you, I think it's all about me, and I aspire to greatness that I can lay hands on the sick and they shall recover. If that happens, to God be the glory. I've been doing this thing for 50 years, called preaching, called ministry. Been serving the Lord since I was 8 years old. And my heart's cry and prayer has always been, don't let me make it about me. Don't let it be about me. You see, this is not my church, it's his church. It's not my ministry, it's his ministry he has called me into. Amen. And I feel so many people get, even being in ministry for years, they forget who they are. If you'll excuse me, we forget our place. I've had members years ago, not recently, praise Jesus, but years ago, you don't know who you're talking to. You don't know what me and my family do for this church. You don't know what we give. You don't know. My great-grandma did this or my grandpa did that. When I first started preaching, it kind of would set me back on my heels. Like, I don't want to ruffle their feathers. Don't want to make them mad. Boy, that'd be a bad day. But the older I'm getting now, it brings me to my toes. I don't shy away. I said, oh, really? You don't know who God is. God is a God who can raise up and bring down just like that. The heart of the king is in his hand. This is his church. He's the head. Hallelujah. We forget. Listen, it's not about a praise team leader. It's not about a praise team. It's not about a pastor. It's not about the men's ministry leader or the women's ministry leader, the children's leader, the youth leader. It's not about any of those. This is God's program. Greatness belongs to him. If we have a great program going on in our church, to God be the glory. All we're doing is consecrating ourselves to that. To him, not just to the program. Wow. So the pattern's been set for amazing things. I thought about Samson in Judges chapter 13 through 16. It will read something like this. There was a woman who was barren who could have no children. The angel of the Lord, which is Jesus, a pre-incarnate of Christ, appears to her and says, oh, you're going to have a baby. He says, and since you're going to have this baby, I want you, as well as the child, to take the Nazarite vow. I want you to abstain from strong drink and wine. I want you to abstain from these things. And the son that's going to be born to you, he's not to touch any dead thing. He's not to drink anything from the vine. It talks about things, the strength, he should not cut his hair. Samson's strength wasn't in his hair. I was taught that as a kid, when he got his hair cut off, he lost his strength. That's not true. His strength was in the vow, the covenant. That's where the strength was. He started failing when he started disobeying God and going against that pattern of greatness. Hear me well. So the woman comes back to her husband, Manoah, whose name means rest, who is from a city called Hornet. from the tribe of the judge. Now, how would you like to have a judge named Hornet presiding over your case? If it comes to Hornet, you can get stung bad, y'all. So, Manoah, whose name means rest, hears his wife's encounter. He says, do it for me too, God. Show up. Come back. Angel of the Lord, come back and talk to us and tell us what we're going to do. How can we raise this boy? What are we supposed to do? So he hears his request. He comes back. He tells him the same thing. And then he says, would you hang loose right here for a little bit? Just bear with us. We want to get you a gift and make an offering. He says, I won't eat anything you bring, but you can bring something. So he brings something, prepares it. The Lord waits for it. Everybody say, wait for it. He's waiting for it. And all of a sudden, they light the fire up to do the burnt offering because he said, I won't eat anything, but you do a burnt offering. I'll be happy in that. And sure enough, all of a sudden, when the fire starts going up, the Lord, angel of the Lord just steps into the flame and whoosh, takes a trip. Man, hallelujah. Manoah's blown away. Him and his wife say, oh, we're about to die now. We done seen the Lord. We're dead people. They had a son, and his name means solar, or the rise like the rising sun, like the S-U-N. I looked at some pictures yesterday. Sister Tarina made me privy to their her nephew, Bill. I didn't get his permission to say his name, but I'm going to say it anyway. Hey, Bill, how you doing, buddy? Proud of you, man. This dude, he has won every state competition in his class for bodybuilding. He went to the national, in this particular national, in the area, this national competition, and ranked, did you say sixth? Wow, ranked sixth. Now, I don't know if you know about that, but there's like bukus and bukus and bukus of bodybuilders out there. And I'm thinking, man. And so I'm looking at these guys, and the boy is cut, y'all. I mean, and you know, when I thought about it, it was just so funny because she didn't know what I was preaching. And she said, Pastor, look at this. This is what I had to look at all day yesterday. I just laughed at her. One guy, it was so funny to me because one guy, I think in this competition stuff, if you know anything about it, they give you an option, spray tanning, and you can spray your face and not. Well, this guy didn't spray his face, and so not their nephew, but this other guy. So this other guy's standing there like this right here, and it looks like he took his head and set it on somebody else's body. I laughed so hard, I thought, that's. But listen, Bill disciplined himself. He's followed patterns to get where he is. See, a lot of us guys want the six-pack, but we can't lay down things to get it. We can't exercise to do that. A lot of us want those big old biceps and triceps. And when your wife comes in the room, you go, she goes, oh, baby, you make me weak in my knees. But we can't put down that 48-ounce gulp and the Twinkie. I'm just going to throw it out there where it's real right now, okay? Okay. A lot of us want to aspire to greatness in the Holy Spirit. We want to see miracles. We want to see things. We want to see God move. We want to pray for the sick and they recover. We want to cast out demons. But how many of us are willing to follow the pattern to get to that place? He said, whom I call, I consecrate. Dedicate yourself to me. Separate. When he told him to be a Nazarite, he was saying, I want you to separate yourself from the world. I want you to separate yourself from these things, and I want you to consecrate yourself to me and let me be mighty in you. Yes. Wow. So this Samson, which reminded me of Bill, about what Samson looked like, I'm sure. Samson went in some of these movies, you see them little wimpy, skinny little guys come in like this right here, and the strength of the Lord comes on. No, I believe the boy was a man's man. Right. Because his name even spoke that. To look at him was like looking at a solar system. Muscles on muscles on, like Popeye. You know? But Samson made a grave error. And I'll tell you about that in a moment. The pattern was set. The pattern was set for Abram. When God calls Abram, here's what he tells Abram. He says, I want you to trust me. I want you to follow me. I want you to believe me. I will bring you, I will bring you into the land that I will show you. I will give it you. I will make you a great nation. I will bless you. I will make your name great. And I will bless those who bless you, curse those who curse you. He said, and in you shall all the families of the earth be blessed. Now, I'm getting ready to step out on something, so I want you to hear me well. Because this is biblical, okay? We talked about in 1948 the Jews becoming a nation again and becoming a state. And they went back to their land. Let me tell you whose possession it is. It's God's possession. Jehoshaphat prayed that when he said, Lord, you see their threats. You see what the enemy's doing? They're coming and wanting to throw us out of your possession, which you've given us to inherit. One thing I like about the Bibleopoly game is you own nothing like you do a Monopoly or a Game of Life. You know, we claim aspire all these great things and all this. But the Bibleopoly game is you tend the property. You don't get the money you are given talents and gifts. You tend the properties that you buy. You see, in America, we've got this falsehood that I own my truck, I own my home, it's mine. No, it's not. Stop paying taxes and see whose it is. Don't belong to us. I'm sorry, I just busted somebody's bubble. I heard it go pow. I saw that person. It's the truth. We brag about what we own, what we've paid off. It's not ours. We are stewards of it. Now, we may not be slave to the lender or the borrower. We're the borrower, slave to the lender. We may not be like that. We may be free from that chain. That's cool. But you still don't own anything. I'm going to go out and do this. No. Lord, it's your possession. I get to inherit it. Jehoshaphat knew that principle. Abraham knew that principle. A pattern had been set. I am God, and you'll be my people. He tells Moses, you lead them out. So when he's telling all these things, he's setting a pattern for you and I. I am the God of your father, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. I'm going to ask you a question. Who was the deliverer of Israel? Don't answer that yet. Who was the deliverer of Israel? Jehovah God or Moses? Jehovah God. I'll help you out there. Moses was the leader. Jehovah God was the deliverer. Because here's what he says. I have seen their afflictions. I've seen the afflictions of my people. I have heard their cry. I know their pain. And I am come down to deliver them. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. He said, now what I want you to do, I need a mouthpiece. I want you to go in there to Pharaoh and you tell him, I am that I am has sent you, and tell him to let my people go. Hallelujah. What are you saying? God's job is to do the amazing things. Ours is to reap the benefits of that and be a part of that. Thank God for gifts and talents, but thank God that we know who he is and what he wants to do for us. Again, the text of Joshua 3 tells us, sanctify, consecrate yourself for tomorrow. God's going to do amazing things among you. The mistake Samson and Moses made, we make the same mistake. We become self-reliant, self-sufficient, self-focused. We forget that we are just the vessel and he is the source. What Nebuchadnezzar did, he stepped out on the balcony after being told about this dream that he had. After being told, said, oh, you, O king, this dream is about you. God's going to come in and the angels are going to come down this great tree that all the birds of the air are sitting in the nests. On the boughs of it and underneath the animals are feeding, you're going to have your nation cut down and taken from you, but God's going to leave the stump. He steps out on the balcony and looks over. He said, is this not great Babylon, which I have built? While the words were yet in his mouth, the Lord said, I'm bringing you into judgment. So listen, as you're aspiring to greatness in whatever field you're in, I'm not knocking that. Praise God. Be the best you can be. But remember, you are the vessel. If God's allowed you to be somewhere, it's because it's for his glory. Yes. I'm just going to preach to you, okay? Something that always blew my mind in Judges. Landon, this always blew my mind, okay? God tells them not to marry into the Philistine camp, but not to marry in the land where they come into, because they'll bring their gods. It will contaminate them. I want you to be a sanctified people set aside for me. I don't want you to be unholy. I don't want you polluting yourself. Amen. And then the Bible says Samson, when he becomes of age, one day he goes down and he sees a Philistine woman. He looks, he says, I like her. He comes home and he says, Dad, get her for me. And here's what the Bible says. It always confused me. And the Bible said, for dad and mom knew not this was of the Lord. Wait a minute now. God just told him he didn't want him to do that. And now this is of the Lord. Here's the key. It wasn't saying God made her attractive to him. It wasn't saying God was sending him to do that. God was looking for an opportunity. Can I just preach to you? God was looking for an opportunity to pick a fight. That's what the Word of God says. He was looking for an opportunity to set the Philistines against them so he could pick a fight with them and show himself strong and mighty. Because he told him, your son is going to start. He's going to start delivering Israel from the hands of the Philistines. Everybody say start. See, he's going to start. He's going to begin. And how is he going to do that? By picking a fight. So he goes down, marries the Philistine girl. And you know how the story goes. He gives them a riddle. He kills this lion with his bare hand. Doesn't tell his mom and dad because, number one, he broke the Nazirite vow. All right, now he's touched something dead. He touches it even more when he goes back by after he reaches into the honeycomb and gets some honey out of the honeycomb of the dead lion. He defied God and broke the vow when he's down at a party getting drunk. Read the story, okay? But what it's saying, God is saying, you want it your way? Have it your way. Oh, but I'm going to use this to my advantage. You may have a plan, and you may think, God, I'm messing up God's plan. God says, no, no, no. I'm going to bring it back around. Anybody ever know what it means to be brought back around? The Word of God says it on the left side of God, okay? We always talk about the right side of God. On the left side of God, behind the scenes, God is doing things with our lives that we have no clue about. We mess up. We make mistakes. Things happen in our lives that shame us. We regret. And God says, oh, you just don't see me working on the left side, bringing it around. It's like dribbling behind the back. Woo! Hallelujah! My God is an excellent ball player. And he dribbled behind the back, said, I got you. I'll bring you back to the right side. I wish I had somebody knew what I was talking about. Some of us were knuckleheads growing up. Some of us did some pretty dumb things, and we were out in left field, and God said, I'll bring you back. Boy, Nathaniel, he wore me out yesterday just watching him. I couldn't do it. I'm tired thinking about it. Man, that boy, they got a song they sing at the church they're going to now, and it was talking about giving God thanks. And they have all these movements and all these things, and these kids are jumping, teenagers, energy, praise God for them. And then they get to this part of it, and I want the youth to learn this. This would be good, okay, Eddie. They get to this part that talks about get up, get up, get up, get up out of that grave. Get up, get, and they do that for like 5 minutes, and I can't get up, get out of the grave. I'm ready to go down. I watched Stephen do it with him. Stephen just turned 44. Celebrate his birthday. Happy birthday, son. Hallelujah. And Stephen, I was watching, and he's doing that with him for a while. And I see Stephen go, he just lays over. Man, I said, boy, when you're 20 years ago, you wouldn't have stopped, son. But they do that get up, get up, get up, get up out of that grave. Get up, get up. And they finally get up, and they're giving God praise and thanks. And I'm thinking, man, God, you want to show yourself mighty on our behalf. God wants us to cheer for him. God cheers for us. Go get him. Hallelujah. That's my boy. That's my girl. That's what God is saying over you. Well, Lord, I did something bad. I made a mistake. I messed up. I sinned. He said, I can bring you back home. I got a plan for your life. I got a destiny. Oh, you may be out in left field right now. You may be on the backside of a desert, Moses. Hallelujah. But I got a plan for your life, and I'm going to bring you where I want you. You know what I'm saying? Let God handle it. Let God handle your marriage. Let God handle your life. Let God handle your plans. Woo! Some people want to make things happen. Make things happen in relationship. Make things happen in marriage. Make things happen on the job. God is saying, you just trust me. We're going to score. Oh, hallelujah. It's going to be a good day. Hallelujah. And he says, after his hair was cut, and this was the final straw that broke the camel's back, he raises up. Here's what the Bible says. I will escape as I will escape as I did before and shake myself free. I am the man. Been there, done that. I know. Come on, people. Don't tell me how to live. I know what I'm doing. These young people, I know what I'm doing, Pastor. Yeah, duh, Samson. Because that's what happened. He forgot the source. Numbers chapter 20, verse 10, Moses' mistake. God says, they're at a place where there was no water. And this time God says, I want you to go and I want you to speak to the rock. First time he smote the rock, okay? Christ is the rock that was smitten for us, okay? He said, I want you to speak to the rock. And what does Moses do? He brings Aaron before the people. He is as mad as a hornet. He looks at them and he says, listen, you bunch of rebels. Must we bring water out of this rock for you? Who said anything about him bringing water out of the rock? A knothead? We're the same way. We think we can do it. Well, Pastor, if you could just preach us happy. Whoop. Well, if you bring the word, oh, hallelujah. Well, if we had a praise team up there just running interference for us, praise God, we'd have a touchdown this morning. Woo, score, hallelujah, praise Jesus. Our focus is on the wrong stuff. Our focus is in the wrong place. All glory, all power, all honor belongs to the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And he said, if I be lifted up, I will draw all men. He didn't say, you get me a good praise team, you get me a good piano player, you get me a good preacher, you get me a good Sunday school teacher, you get me a good children's pastor, youth pastor, and I'll grow your church. No, no. He said, and I, if I be lifted up, I will draw. Oh, God. I aspire to greatness for Somerville Family Worship Church. I really do. But it's not about us. I just want us to be consecrated, dedicated. So here now, Samson had a reality check, but he did not know the Lord had left him. Now, you know, it says in the New Testament, I'll never leave you nor forsake. What he's saying is he backed off. Go ahead. You wanted it? Have it your way. His eyes were put out, grinding in the meal. They made a mockery of him. They brought him out before 3,000 people with all the Lord Philistines, all their gods and idols sitting all around, and they were paying homage and worshiping, mocking. Look, our gods, what they did. They delivered this guy to us. His God couldn't stop him. And that kind of made him real mad then. I mean, he was mad enough, his eyes were put out. He was mad enough to joke, and now they're messing with his God. So he says, God, hear me this one last time. One more time, God, hear me. Let my strength be restored, that I can avenge my eyes. They took my eyes. But God, and if need be, here's what he said. I'm willing to die with these Philistines. So he pushes down the pillars. And in a militant act, lays his life down and sacrifices his life. Well, he's mentioned in Faith's Hall of Fame, yes, Hebrews 11. So is Moses. God tells Moses, because you did not trust me to sanctify me in the eyes of the people, to make my name great, to make my name holy, to consecrate me, you will not bring them into the promised land. Aaron was taken up on a mountain, the priest, And with priestly apparel was stripped away from him. Moses was taken on Mount Nebo. He said, you can look at the land, but you can't take them in. Now, I know somewhere in that Moses repented of his hot-headedness. He's mentioned in Faith's Hall of Fame. And I know because in Jude, the devil's disputing with Michael the archangel over the body of Moses. You see, no one knows where Moses was buried because God took him back in the mountain and buried him. Had a private ceremony. Come here, boy. I love you, son. Come over here. I know you messed up, but it's okay. You can look, but you're not going to go over it. But I got plans for you. So what was his plans for him? Matthew chapter 17 on the Mount of Transfiguration. Moses had never got to touch the promised land. Till that day, God said, you know, messed up, but boy, I'm going to bring you back around. I wish I had a basketball right now. Woo! I'm going to bring you back around. Hallelujah. And so when Jesus is there, Elijah representing the prophets, Moses representing the law, they're standing there. And in the Mount of Transfiguration, Jesus is transformed, shining like Samson. Shining like the sun between two pillars. Hallelujah! Who would be willing just in a little while to sacrifice himself to save? Hallelujah! And Moses and the law and the prophets were brought and fulfilled in him. First time, Gary, he couldn't lead him over. He couldn't step on the promised land. But that day, he not only got to stand on the promises, he got to stand with the promise. Hallelujah. You see, it's one thing to stand on the promises. It's another thing to stand with the promises. Glory to God. Woo! I'm going to do like that airplane now. I'm circling, getting ready, making my descent. Hallelujah. The will of the Lord, hallelujah, he delivers. So the call to Joshua, to the people in Joshua chapter 3, don't move until he does. When you see the priest that bear his presence get up, you go after him. But you stay a distance back because we've never been this way before. Follow him. Don't get right up on him and get cluttered and don't know where you're going. Follow them. Follow the leading of the Lord. Whew, hallelujah. Don't move till he moves. Follow his presence because he knows where he's going. Consecrate yourselves, for tomorrow the Lord will do amazing things among you. So in closing, I want to share something from Mark Batterson's book, Amazing Things in All In. He said, and I quote, in The Circle Maker, the prequel to this book, I wrote about in the importance of prayer. It's the difference between the best you can do and the best God can do. You've got to pray a circle around the promises of God the same way the Israelites circled Jericho. And you keep circling until he answers. But you can't just pray like it depends on God alone. You also have to work like it depends on you as well. You can't draw the circle and just walk away. No, you have to draw a line in the sand. You're only one decision away. And this is you today, friend. You listening in the sanctuary, you watching. In a moment, I'm going to give an opportunity to come forward, to consecrate ourselves, rededicate ourselves to the Lord, and say, God, we want you to show yourself mighty in Somerville. We want you to show yourself mighty in our homes and in our lives. So where you are, you can, in your home, you can make that declaration today. Hallelujah. You're one decision away from a totally different life. Of course, it will probably be the toughest decision you've ever made. But if you do, and you have the courage to do so, you'll surrender yourself to the Lordship of Jesus Christ. There's no telling what God will do. D.L. Moody left an indelible imprint. And I told my wife when I preached this message for Mother's Day, the indelible impression, I hadn't even seen this, but now, boom. He left an indelible imprint on his generation in the late 1800s. His sermons contributed to a great spiritual awakening worldwide. More than a century later, his passion for the gospel continues to indirectly influence millions of people through Moody Church, Moody Bible Institute, and Moody Publishers. Moody left an amazing legacy, but it all started with a call to consecration. It always does. Nothing's changed, friend. The world has yet to see what God will do with, for, through, and in a man or a woman who is fully and wholly consecrated to Him. Why not you? Gracie, why not you? Yes. Todd, why not you? Yes. Hannah, why not you? Kaylee, why not you? Landon, why not you? And why not now? Yes. Amazing things. Anytime God's about to do something amazing in our lives, He calls us first to consecrate ourselves to Him. The pattern has been established. I'm sharing with you this morning. Consecrate yourself, for tomorrow the Lord will do amazing things among you. And He shares this up in closing. He shares this, and I love this. He says, here's our fundamental problem. We try to do God's job for Him. We want to do the amazing things, but that's God's job, not ours. Before I tell you what consecration is, he says, I'll tell you what it's not. It's not going to church once a week. It's not daily devotions. It's not fasting during Lent. It's not keeping the Ten Commandments. It's not sharing your faith with friends. It's not giving God the tithe. It's not repeating the sinner's prayer. It's not volunteering for a ministry at church. It's not leading a small group. It's not raising your hands in worship. It's not even going on a mission trip. He says all of these things are good things, but it's not consecration. It's more than a behavior modification. It's more than conformity to a moral code. It's more than doing good deeds. It's something deeper, something truer. You see, for the word consecrate means to set yourself apart. By definition, it means it demands full devotion. It's dethroning yourself and enthroning Jesus Christ. Can you imagine the people, what God could do in our community if we would dethrone ourselves and put Him on the throne? Amen. Just asking. It's complete divestiture or stripping away of all self-interest. It's giving God veto power. It's surrendering all of you to all of Him. It's a simple recognition that every second of the day, every second of time, every ounce of energy, every penny of money, God, it's a gift from you and it's for you. I'm going to consecrate ever so deeply to the love for Jesus. I'm going to consecrate with a childlike trust in the Heavenly Father. I'm going to consecrate in a blind obedience, a blind saying, I walk by faith and not by sight to the Holy Spirit. Consecration is all that and a thousand things more, but to simplify it for you today, he says, consecration is going all in and all out for the all in all. Wow. The pattern's been set. Next week I'm going to talk about the pattern being set for amazing things. I'm going to continue this walk. And again, Sister Jenny, it just might be for me. It may not be for you. But this is where I am right now in my walk. I feel God is calling me to a greater consecration. Yes. Because I want to see amazing things take place. I want to see Him shine. We used to sing that song years ago, Shine, Jesus, shine. Man, now it's, we want programs to shine and people to shine. And I've had people, if we could only get this person for revival, woo, couldn't we have church? I've had people talk about pastors, because I am one. Well, if we only had somebody as a pastor like this one or like you or like that one, boy, we could really do something, Pastor. More about Jesus, let me know. Yes. More, tell me more about Jesus. More about Jesus. You want to see God do great things in your home, in your life? Make it more about Him and less about you. Less about church, less about busyness, less about obligation. Make it more about serving Him. Amen. Amen. Praise team, if you would come, please. Hallelujah. My. Thank you, Lord, for your word. My heart's cry is for Him to be glorified. Had someone tell me, Kenny told me this morning, Pastor, it's not only going to be through you, but I believe it's going to be through others in this church. We'll be able to lay hands on the sick and they'll recover. I said, I believe that. I receive that. Because it's not about the preacher touching someone. No, it's about Jesus touching someone. Pastor, if you could just come to my home and pray for my husband, I believe it. I don't mind doing that. But you see, what your husband needs is an encounter with God. A true encounter. Not just a prayer, not just the way I feel, I'm sorry. No, a true encounter. This, he walks away when he knows God says, what was the first thing he told Moses when he started approaching the bush? Ah! Take your shoes off. You're on holy ground, boy. What's he saying? Consecrate, you sanctify yourself. Don't you approach me like that. Jesus says, come as you are. Now we can come. Amen. But even in that, he said, casting all our cares, laying our sins down at the feet, letting him change us. More about Jesus, let me know. Wow. Father God. So this is your opportunity, friend. Watching by way of live stream here live in the sanctuary. This is in no way to suggest that you aren't where you're supposed to be. It's no way to insult you to say, you're not consecrated, you need to tighten up. No, this is just a pastor sharing the heart of God with you today, that he has placed the word on my heart. This is just to be honest with you. This is a mouthpiece desiring his word to speak forth. Some people are so holier than thou, boy. They can tell you what's going on and what's wrong. And like, oh, God. Can't we? I'd love to see the Lord shake some people like that. It may look like that, but I'd love to see him shake some of them just to say, I'm God. I do whatever I want to do. I don't know how he's going to do it, but I know he is. I don't know how he's going to take Sister Helen's situation, work it to that, bringing it back around, but I know he is. I don't know how he's going to work it all for you, but I've already seen him. Woo! Oh. What did he say? I love that song. No, excuse me just a moment. I love that song. I see him rolling up. I see him rolling up. Isaiah tells us that. God's rolling. Listen to that. When God rolls up his sleeves, look out. He's getting ready to do something for us. I see him rolling up his sleeves again. I see him getting ready to say, oh, I want to bless my church. I want to bless my people. Let me show myself mighty on your behalf. You fought it by yourself long enough. You've tried to handle it on your own. You try to do it your way. Let me bring you back home. Oh, hallelujah, hallelujah. Spirit of the living God. Glory and honor, power and praise be to the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Do we have anybody in this building to say, Pastor, I want to rededicate. I want to consecrate. I'm giving myself wholly to the Lord today. Praise God. This is your time to come. At home, where you are, you stand before the Lord or kneel before the Lord. Say, God, I'm yours. Take all of me. All of me. Take all of me. Don't know him as your Savior. This is your chance. This is your opportunity. Say, God, I want to be drawn closer to you. Show yourself mighty. In the name of Jesus.
For our Lord God Almighty reigns.
Say hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah.
Paul had it right. He said, it is in him I live, I breathe, I move, I have my being. The Lord Jesus had it right. Who you calling good? There's none good but the Father in heaven. It's about him. God, let us get it. Let us get it today. Well, at the risk of sounding like I'm plagiarizing somebody, I don't mean to. Want to welcome you to the neighborhood today. I'm so thankful you chose to be here to be my neighbor. I love you. Hey, listen, I got a book in my library about that guy. He was a pretty tough guy when you study his life. Man, amazing. Love the Lord. I'm grateful for that. So, well, I'm not supposed to be up here now. I think some... Just, oh, okay, now won't you do it? I've said enough. Oh, go ahead. Thank you for being with us.
Praise the Lord. Oh, Lord, it is so good to be in your presence. Oh, hallelujah. Oh, Lord, I don't even want to leave this place. But, Lord, I know you go with us wherever we go. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Father, for ministering here today, Lord. Your spirit is so sweet today. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Praise your name. Oh, Lord Jesus.
Roll up your sleeves, God. Show yourself high on your children's behalf, God. Our nation's lost, God. World and culture lost, God.
Praise the Lord.
Show yourself high. Let your church awake out of the sleep and slumber, oh God.
Praise God. Pastor, please have a visitor today. He asked me a little while ago. Amen.
The same prayer fast, just as you pray. Just as you pray.
Amen. Amen. The glory. He's on the move. Amen. Amen. God is on the move. God is on the move. I love you, church. I appreciate you, folks. Thank you for being so kind to us and just listening. I better stop before I get started again.